Here we see the proton secretion facilitates bicarbonate reabsorption at the nephron's PCT. In the figure, top left, we have a cartoon of the nephron. Right here is the nephron's proximal convoluted tubule. Make a cross-section through a segment of that tubule. We see it like this. We blow up the right side of the tubule wall, and we get that wall separating the tubular fluid, mainly put there by the filtration process, and the extracellular fluids, that is the renal ISF and blood. Note that in the tubular fluid, we have bicarbonate. Bicarbonate is freely filtered at the glomerulus, regardless of the acid-base status of the subject. This is a somewhat indiscriminate process, and it's very powerful. But interestingly, under normal conditions, 100% of that filtered bicarbonate is reabsorbed into the bloodstream. If you sample the urine leaving the kidneys, no bicarbonate should be present in that urine. The reabsorption process is indirect. I'll explain what I mean by that in a moment, as is the secretion of protons, which are necessary for bicarbonate reabsorption to occur. So let's tackle this. What does all this mean? Well, bicarbonate is unable to cross the apical membrane of PCT cells. PCT apical membranes are impermeable to bicarbonate. There are no carriers built into the membrane. We can't get bicarbonate in that form across that apical membrane. So instead, we combine it with protons to form carbonic acid, which as it builds up, dissociates into carbon dioxide and water. Yeah, you're right. We're taking our carbonic acid equation and we're running it in a reverse direction because we have high concentrations of bicarbonate and protons. We need protons to reabsorb bicarbonate. As the CO2 is released by the dissociation of H2CO3, as a lipid-soluble gas, it easily enters the tubular cell across the apical membrane. Stay with me on this. In the cytoplasm of the PCT cell, we will reform carbonic acid in an enzyme-catalyzed process. Carbonic anhydrase catalyzes this hydration. As H2CO3 is produced in the tubular cell, it separates into protons and bicarbonate. The protons are transported back into the tubular fluid by two mechanisms, a sodium proton countertransporter or antiporter, and also a proton pump. The proton pump is primary active transport. It pumps protons against their gradient and requires the energy from ATP to do so. The sodium proton countertransporter is secondary active transport. It brings one sodium into the cell for every proton that comes out. This needs the electrochemical gradient that's set up by primary active transport, the sodium-potassium pump on the basolateral membrane. That pump pumps three sodiums out of the cell for every two potassiums in. It needs energy from ATP to function, and it sets up the electrochemical gradient to drive the sodium proton countertransporter on the apical membrane. What about the bicarbonate? Bicarbonate, as it builds in concentration in the cytoplasm of the PCT cell, is easily transported by two different carriers into the interstitial fluid. One is a sodium bicarbonate cotransporter, the other a bicarbonate chloride countertransporter. We've just indirectly reabsorbed filtered bicarbonate, and we have secreted protons, and we've done it in an indirect process. I have something for you to think about here. Wouldn't it be great if we had a subject that was severely acidotic, if we could not only secrete protons and reabsorb filtered bicarbonate, if we could add further to the bicarbonate concentration of the blood? Yes, it would be. The problem is, even in normal people, 100% of filtered bicarbonate is reabsorbed. How can you do better than that? Well, actually, you can. The kidneys can produce their own bicarbonate. It's called new bicarbonate. And the way it's done is to take CO2 from the blood, have it enter the cell, go through the process that we just discussed, the protons secreted into the tubular fluid and the bicarbonate absorbed back into the blood. That's extra bicarbonate that was just produced de novo.